What we are doing right now is we are focusing in on what is truly important, truly cool, truly hip, and that is what? Okay, that is where it's at right now. And we need to be hip to the times and understand what is going on, because there's actually an attempt to distract us away from this very important focus. So we need to be right on this focus right now. I tried to drop all my resistance to the Darshan. Now Darshan, let's take a look at Darshan. Darshan is like a Sanskrit term. Darshan means a viewing of what? A viewing of divinity, actually. A viewing of divinity. What we need right now is a Darshan of the Christ child. And I tried to drop all my resistance to that yesterday evening before going to bed. And the dream was not what I expected, because in the dream I found myself in the entourage of this goddess. And at first it seemed incredible and amazing, but as the dream unfolded, things started to go weird. They started to go weird eventually, and I said, whoa, no, I don't want this. So it seems like within us, deep down within us, there is this distractive dynamic present as we try to go towards the viewing of, the looking, the seeing, the viewing of this Christ child within us, which is a God's gift to us, a gift of remembrance of what we really are. There is this dynamic of this goddess there who says, hey, have Darshan of me, look at me. I'm preparing you for Darshan of the Christ child. And what I have found in my long experience with this trouble is that it doesn't really prepare you for the Darshan of the Christ child. What it does is it gradually gets weirder and weirder and leads you away from Darshan of the Christ child. But initially, the goddess gives you the impression that she is very close to divinity, and that the viewing of her will prepare you for the Christ, viewing the Christ child. But again, it leads you away, very cleverly leads you away. So I woke up this morning feeling terrible, very heavy, just like half dead. I didn't even know how I could function today. It's awful. So again, have to make a renewed effort, saying no to that dynamic of distraction. If you are viewing something within your psyche, within your perception, whether it's during waking time or dreaming time, and it is anything other than this sort of like small child, which is genderless, sort of this genderless small child that is simply radiating this perfect assurance of no death. There is no such thing as death. If you find yourself anything other than that, it's not it. It's not it. And it's not getting you ready for what's it. That's the trick. It is not. So whether it's some, you know, male spiritual master or some female goddess, master, whatever you want to call it, that's not it. That is not it. Anything that has its feeling of gender is not it. It is not the Christ child. Period. Christ child gives you the feeling like there's absolutely no gender and no feeling of flesh with them either. You don't get the feeling of flesh, even though it appears as a human form. You don't get the feeling of gender or flesh or age or anything. You just get this pure purity of reassurance, purity of reassurance. And we can have Darshan of that. In fact, that is what we must do. We must have a viewing of this within us. It's within us. It's within our mind, within our spirit. The Christ child is within us. And all we have to do is simply look, accept it, and accept this. Just look. where it is. Where it is, it's not going to jump out in front of you and say, hey, look at me, me. It's quiet, it's still, it's just where it is. And we have to turn our attention there, where it is. And before we do that, the goddess jumps up and says, hey, I'm so glad that you're ready to look at the Christ child. And I'm right here, and I'm going to prepare you for that. So look at me, and I will prepare you. And you have to say no to the goddess. Say no to the goddess. Say no, no. I'm ready to directly look at the Christ child right now. That's it. You're not it. You are not it. So butt out. And it's a matter of just turning your attention away from that. Turn it away. But right before you get there, these distractions will jump up and say, look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me. So we have reached the point where we have to do this. We have to decide, okay, direct darshan, direct viewing. Just view. That's all. Just a viewing. Not an interrogation. And the Holy Spirit has pointed out to me that the position of the Christ child is the correct position to have on existence. It will not justify itself. It will not really explain itself. And you may think, well, how come it's looking, it's not reacting to things, specific things. It has this blanket reassurance. And you might bring up some social problem, some illness. Well, can you heal this or do this? And the Christ child will not pay any attention to that. And people might struggle and say, hey, this, how come you're not, you know, healing our afflictions, etc. The purpose of the Christ child is remembrance. For our remembrance of reality. There's no sickness in reality. There's no death in reality. There's nothing, no trouble whatsoever in reality. So we are simply getting reassurance of this fact. Christ child is not here running around to run around and take care of what troubles us, so to speak. It's here to solve the continuity problem for us. Now perhaps stuff will iron out, the wrinkles will be ironed out through the darshan. I don't know. That's possible. Maybe, maybe not. That's not the point of it. That's not what it's there for. So we have to accept it on its terms. Okay? It's not going to change for us. We have to be willing to accept it on its terms. And it is just there. It is just there. Radiating out this presence. It's not singling out anything. It's not reacting to anything. It's not reacting to what's going on. It doesn't see your suffering. It doesn't see your death. It doesn't see your sickness. It doesn't see anything like that. It's radiating this perfect no to death. And of course, as we pick this up in the viewing, the inner viewing, we will also start radiating that no to death. It may not be perfect, but we'll start, it will begin, it will increase and amplify. And in so doing, various forms of this will start, you know, fleeing from us, like a magnet repelling it. Without us having to do anything specifically about it. So it's the affirmation of truth which drives away afflictions. Like Christian Science had it right, and you don't address the illness at all. You just affirm that it is not real, and therefore doesn't exist at all. Doesn't really exist at all. There is a way to expel, you know, all afflictions from us because they're only presumptions. Very presumptuous. All this is very presumptuous. Existence is very presumptuous. and you break the spell of the presumption, it's gone. So, the darshan, the viewing of the Christ child within us, is on its terms. The Holy Spirit's job is to explain these terms to us so that we can say, okay. Now, I had this dream where the Christ child was talking with me and telling me, I was brushing my teeth, and they said, I love the way you brush your teeth. It was very, very good. And saying, it's just like so enthused about the way I brush my teeth. I said, huh? And it probably had to do with like brushing up, you know, symbolized brushing up. What is to brush up on something? It means to get familiar with it. I needed to brush up on something, get off the rust, get clear about it. You know, like let's say you're a musician, you haven't played in a while, you're a little rusty. You brush up on your technique, you brush up on the songs, you brush up on everything, and you're ready to go. So the Christ child was saying, hey, you've done a great job brushing up on everything, you know, you're ready to go. And then I then knocked on its door, and it was the stairway somehow went down into like a den or something, but it wasn't aware of the world. I mean, it's you go down and you're not seeing the world, apparently. I didn't see, it's a stairway leading down, so to speak. So in other words, it symbolizes you're not aware or reacting to the world when you have this darshan. What's happening in the world is not important. It's merely a presumption. And we are ending presumption. Okay, we're ending the presumption that we can die, that we can ever learn how to die. That is the presumption we have. We're going, existence is again, rests on a foundation of presumption, not fact. We're presuming that we can learn how to die spiritually. Reality can die. Like we spray Roundup on it, you know, and it shrivels up and dies. It's not, and the Christ child tells us, no, that's not possible. And this is this effortless certitude that we get. So I went and knocked on the door, and I said, "Hey, I'd like to see you." And the Christ child said, "Yes, who's that?" And I said my name, and said, "Ah, wonderful, 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 great, great! Can't wait to see you. Just one second, just one moment." And I guess, hopefully, it's going to open the door, as it were. I guess you knock and ask, and you shall receive. So I was able to interact directly with it. And just straightforward, you know, this child is so completely unpretentious, no pretensions whatsoever. Completely straight, innocent, straight, pure, but still happy and engaging and can talk with us. But there's no pretension there, so that rubs off on us. You know, I just said, hey, I'm just gonna knock on the door and say, hey, I'd like to see you. I said, you there? Yeah. This is Ross. Are you there? And he said, ah, Ross, oh, that's great, 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 great. And he's just, very happy that I knocked on the door. So, there is this within us. And of course, the goddess tries to butt in and say, well, I'm his mom, and you need to go through me to, you know, to talk to the Christ child. But the Christ child does not have a mother. The Christ child is a creation of the Holy Spirit. All right? And the Holy Spirit does not have a gender. So you can't even call a father, doesn't have a father, doesn't have a mother, really. It's from the Holy Spirit. And that's why it feels genderless. So the way to the Christ child is not through the mother, the goddess mother. It's through the Holy Spirit. So I listened to the Holy Spirit. And the goddess, of course, was insisting that the way is through her. So I also listened to her. I said, this is very confusing. But the way that it is sorted out is that it's through the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit is the one that prepares us, that helps us brush up on what we need to know in order to have the darshan of the Christ child. that is within our psyche, okay? And occasionally we have dreams of this, and occasionally we have experiences of this, and we, for a moment, for an instant, it's called the holy instant, that for an instant we get a glimpse of the Christ child, and it's like, wow. Now, well, of course I've had these glimpses in some more prolonged interactions, and it's just like, just, you know, you can't, you're speechless, really, speechless. It doesn't really give rise to speech. Because what happens is there's this kind of subtle recognition that takes place. And speech is like a blurring of it. You know, for instance, let me write this down, recognition. So, there's this subtle recognition taking place here. And if you start trying to explain what's taking place, it's kind of like, you know, like this. It's kind of using like an eraser to erase the, you know, the subtlety of it. The whole purpose of it is in the subtlety of it. So trying to put into words is at cross purposes to the whole thing. We can speak in large, abstract ways about it, sure. But that in itself is not the subtlety of it. There's some sort of subtle recognition, which is why they say the darshan is done in silence. And that doesn't necessarily mean words are prohibited, but trying to capture the subtlety, it eludes that, really. It eludes it. Because the recognition is beyond time, beyond space, beyond concepts, beyond perception, beyond words. Because words are relative, aren't they, to other words? Think about it. Right? Words are relative to other words. Symbols are relative to other symbols. They have no meaning in themselves. The only meaning they have is this relativity. You say, well, this word is not these other words. If there were just one word, it wouldn't be a word, would it? If there were just one concept. Concepts, by their very nature, are dualistic, meaning there has to be more than one. And then people get into saying, well, pure subjectivity or something. But it lacks the juice of a concept. So, I and you, you know, just pure I has no meaning. One concept has no meaning. One word doesn't really have any meaning. Words are relative to other words. It's a system of words, like numbers are relative to other numbers. But what we are getting is a sense of knowing, which is different than concepts, than duality. There isn't an other. There is no other there. So this is something that is easily dealt with, really. It's not a big issue. So what we're just mentioning it is as part of the brushing up. We're brushing up on stuff here right now. Now these videos are a brush up, really, on preparing us for the darshan of the Christ child. Now the question is somebody who's having the darshan of the Christ child, can they help others? I don't know. I really don't know. Possible. Possible. You would think so. You would think so. And at that time, issues will arise, you know, of how to make the best use of that situation. But really, the Christ child is not any external guru. It is within us. The external gurus are only turning us, helping us brush up so we can turn then in the direction of this Christ child. They're also encouraging us. They're reassuring us that, yes, it is there. It is there. This inner, you can turn your attention to this inner presence. It is there, and you can do it. That benefit, we'll find it. We'll find out. You know, somebody's going to do it at some point here. Someone's going to do that. Do it. Going to look. It's just a matter of looking. You know, I haven't done it yet, but we'll see. You know, possible. And there may be someone, you know, it just will just emerge, and they've looked, they've truly looked, and are looking. But we will not be tricked by the goddess any longer. Been there, done that. That's finished. No doubt that'll show up too. There's no doubt. They'll say, "Oh, everybody, great. The Christ child is great. This is great. Okay, now here, I'm here to help you get ready for that, you know." And then, you know, but you'll be easily able to see the difference. You'll be able to see the difference. You'll be able to tell the difference. It's not going to be a problem. The goddess only says, "Well, of course I know the Christ child. It's my child. How can I not know it?" But they're not having darshan of the child. No, they're busy setting up their own kingdom, their own, you know, ashram, their own cult, their own movement, their own, you know, them. And they say, "Well, that's not important. I know the Christ child. It's my child. Every mother knows its child." Not true at all. As a matter of fact, most mothers don't really know their children very well at all. Children, this just simply isn't true. You know, but in this case, it's really not true. That's like saying duality knows the oneness, a perception knows knowing. It does not. Perception does not know knowing. Concepts don't know oneness. So there's this assumption that the goddess claims, "This is my child." It's not the goddess's child. So that falls down on that account too. It falls down on all accounts, actually. Remember in scripture, the birth, Jesus was the Father, quote unquote, was the Holy Spirit, but it was also the Mother too. Now, the flesh body could have been born by a woman, but the flesh body is neutral. So saying, it's neutral, not in the perfect know of the Holy Spirit, it's just nothing. The flesh body is not, it's just like a microphone or a loudspeaker or a communication device, a gadget. Okay, it's just a gadget. Nothing is there. So the indwelling spirit that was there, using this gadget we call body, that was not born of a woman or a man. That was born of the Holy Spirit. And Jesus was this one who had alignment, was viewing the Christ child. Okay. Or some say it was an actual appearance of the Christ child in the flesh. Either way, the Christ child is within all of us. And it's not born of any flesh at all. So that's very important to point this stuff out. Otherwise, easy to get overwhelmed by the sophistry of the goddess, of the mother, claiming that she's the one who gave birth to this child, and it's from her. And so she must know it, and then we can get the knowledge from her. That's a lie. That's the big lie of the ego. Because Jesus said, admonished his mother, didn't he? He says, you know, quite a few occasions, like she does, you know, he really did. And so let's pay attention to that. And just because that it's a child, there's a tendency to think that mothers know how to deal with it or something. That is not true. It's a child in that it is genderless and that it is really ageless and fleshless. That's what the child is symbolizing. Has no worldly agenda at all. Okay, that's what it's... Jesus said, except you become as a little child, you should not enter the kingdom of heaven, okay? But he means, except you have darshan of the Christ child within you, you shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. In other words, you will not remember reality, so you will not have the continuity problem solved for you. And you won't go back. You won't drop perception until you have the continuity problem solved for you. Now, I first came across the Christ child in his dream, where I was wandering along the edge of this huge dark forest, very spooky, scary forest. And I looked, and right outside the forest, by the side of the road, was this baby, like in swaddling clothes, and this infant, really. And I started to walk past. I noticed everybody's walking past this infant. Everyone's walking, paying no attention, and I started walking past, and then I stopped. And then I just stood there, and I just waited for quite some time. We're just watching. And then I started saying, hey, does anyone know who this infant belongs to? People said, no, I don't know. No, not. I said, wow. And it started getting dark late in the day. And I said, holy cow. You know, there's wolves and wild animals and bad. I said, cold. I said, I can't leave this child, this infant here by the side of the road. And nobody was even paying attention until finally I said, wow. So I picked up the infant and I took it with me. And in the dream, I went back to my town and then I went around telling everybody, hey, I found this infant. Whose is it? Everybody shut their door on me. They said, get out of here. It's not ours. We don't know anything about it. Nobody would give me the time of day. And so I said, oh my gosh, I'm stuck with it. I'm stuck. This is terrible. I said, I don't know how to raise this infant. I got no clue. I'm clueless. And I said, this. And then I apologized to the infant. I said, I'm stuck with you. Nobody will help me. And I'm sure I'm going to bungle your upbringing, you know, terribly. And I just feel awful about this. But I'll do the best that I can. And at that point, this little baby suddenly morphed into this pure golden flowing light and began to give this delightful play of some sort. It was just completely divine, a divine play or something. And then I suddenly realized, oh my God, this is the Christ child. I picked up the Christ child. I was really shocked, very shocked. So the thing is that most people pass it by. It's there within us, but most people have no time for it. They don't want it. And so I said, look, I just felt a sense that I have to deal with this. You know, I can't pass it by. And so then I've been stuck ever since with it. Say, what do I do? I've got this child within me, and I don't know what to, you know, how to relate to it or what to do about it or any, you know, it's really been quite a strain. So the Holy Spirit has been helping me try to understand that this is within everyone, actually. It just, they're so worldly, they pass it by. They don't want to bother with it. They say, no, it's not mine. It's not my child. It's not my child. And that's what everyone said to me. It's not my child. And I said, okay. I said, it's not mine either. But, you know, I'm not going to leave it there to die. That's what I said. I'm not going to leave it there to die. And they said, well, that's your problem. It's not our problem. It's not our child. It's not our problem. That's what they told me. It's not our child. And this is the voice of the flesh. Okay. They were saying, it's not our fleshly child. Okay. So it's not our problem. That's the attitude I got from everybody. I couldn't find anybody that had any sympathy, you know, for me. And for the child. I said, it's not our child. I said, it's not mine either, but, I'll take care of it. I'm not going to just let it die. And then it revealed itself, you know. You know, bingo, lucky you. you hit the lottery, you know. And I said, uh-oh, wow, what have I got myself into here? So, I've been trying to brush up on this child, Christ child. Because I have to, you know, I'm aware that it's there, it's within. It's within me, it's there within everybody, but in my case, I'm aware of it. And of course, the goddess said that she could help me brush up on it. And that got me into a lot of trouble, as a matter of fact. Because eventually it was leading me in the wrong direction. Very much so. So I had to, you know, try to extract myself from the grip of the goddess, which has not been easy, actually. It's the Holy Spirit that's the one that has helped and clarified and done a great job. The Holy Spirit's done a great job. And maybe that's what the Christ child was telling me. Hey, your brushing is just really great. I just love it. It's just really, really good. Just great. You know, hey, it's the Holy Spirit that's done the brush up work, you know, to kind of clarify for me. Hey, what is this child? Why is it here? You know, it's like, where'd it come from? That's the question. I said, where'd it come from? Why is it here? And why me? And what's going on here? And the Holy Spirit clarifies all of that and has clarified it. So, you know, the ego just tries everything again to inflate you, say, oh, you're so important, you're special, and all this nonsense, and then deflate, tries to do everything it can to keep you away from the darshan of the Christ child, because it just simply, you realize there is no death, nothing could die, and life cannot die. That's the Christ child, just radiates this assurance, life cannot die, never. And the reassurance is so pure, it gets into you. You feel the purity of it. Are concepts pure? No. Even the most pure concept is not really pure, is it? And we reach that, conundrum, don't we? No matter what, we can't find a pure concept. We cannot. So, we have to go beyond that to the actual darshan of the Christ child and experience this Christ consciousness directly, not indirectly, directly experience it. So there really is no pure concept. That is the issue, isn't it? No matter what we do, it's still on a foundation of relativity. Reality does not rest on a foundation of relativity. It abides in itself, purely in itself. It is not a construct. It is not relative to anything. It simply is. It is what it is. Great day, great day here in the Bay Area. But horrible day for how I felt today. Just a incredible heaviness. Wow. But took it in good stead now. As far as a sense of urgency about how do we push with a panicked urgency? No. But here's a way to use the term urgency. Is be urgent in your consistency. All right? Have an urgent sense that I need to be consistent walking, continue to walk. Steady walk. Don't stop. You know, you can think about it, but don't do it. Be urgent in your focus on continuity and perseverance of walking. That's the right use of urgency. Don't break into a frantic run, panicked run, that sort of urgency. That's wrong. Keep your steady progress, but have the sense of urgency that you need to keep your progress steady and relentless. So be urgent toward your relentlessness. That is how I would advise to approach the situation right now. Keep brushing up. Keep brushing up. I mean, I was told directly by the Christ child, you've got great brush up technique. You're doing a great job brushing up. So it must be, you know, we must be doing something good here. And it feels like it, that we're certainly getting the right perspective and point of view towards the situation, actually demystifying it. Again, the Christ child is within everyone, without exception. The ones that you think are lost, or you know, there's some very bad habits that arise in this training program we call death, existence. Within this presumption that we can die to what we are, within this presumption, some very bad habits arise. There's no question about that. A lot of very bad habits arise, and those bad habits are certainly acting out upon the stage at this time, as they have throughout history, and right now they're acting very strongly. So there's the presumption, part of the presumptiveness is that the Christ child is not within them. That's why they're acting out. That is not true. It is within them. They're simply not looking at it. They're just saying, it's not my child. It's not of the flesh. So they're still caught up in this belief that the flesh is real, the flesh, that this training program is necessary, and we have to succeed in dying to what we are. Of course, if you want to believe you can die, you're going to believe that the flesh is real, right? And the flesh is what you are, so because that only the flesh can appear to die. So they just pass the Christ child by, but it is within them. It is there. So you can't give up on anyone at all, because it's the Christ child is within everyone. It's within the one mind. We all share the one mind. There's only one mind. We all are of that one mind. And it's in the one mind. The Christ child is within the mind. It's within all of us. But bad habits are hard to break. There's no question about that. It takes a determined effort to break bad habits. It takes the Holy Spirit to break bad habits. We have to heed its advice. Listen and heed its advice. But every bad habit can be diminished to the extent that we can decide to take darshan of the Christ child. So, don't think that we have to spend all our time admonishing others because, you know, bad habits won't listen. But they're not lost. No one's lost. They'll just delay for a little while longer. And who the worst offenders are, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, that really doesn't is not really to the point of the situation, because what we need to do is have the darshan of the Christ child, which reassures us that all is well in reality. It's not reacting to the world. It doesn't react to the world. Inner reassurance. We say there is this inner reassurance within us, and let others know that this is so. And gradually that percolates down through the collective consciousness, through the one mind. And at some point, those with really bad habits, and there are those on the stage right now who are very skilled sophists. Sophistry is the art of... it plays upon our belief that there's such a thing as a pure concept. Okay? And sophistry uses the leverage of our desire for a pure concept to its advantage, and it manipulates us conceptually to pay attention to it. It's sort of speaking out of both sides of its mouth, as it were. And there are some very skilled sophists in the highest positions on the planet right now. Two of them are President of the United States and the Pope, actually, to name just two. So we are getting a double dose of sophistry right now. And it seems, you know, it seems, but remember, there's no such thing as a pure concept. We have to have darshan of the Christ child. Period. Drop concepts. Set them aside. They're still there, but you're not looking for a pure concept. You say that there can't be one, so I don't need to look there anymore. Whereas the sophists are saying, look within the field of concepts. We can manipulate concepts and make beautiful concepts. Not true, because it doesn't solve the continuity problem. It still rests entirely on presumption. Therefore, it doesn't remind you of reality at all. So it doesn't solve the continuity problem. It's just delaying. It's delaying tactics. Sophistry is delaying tactics. And sophistry tries to be all things to everyone. We can appeal to everyone, because we say one thing to somebody and another thing to somebody else, you know, opposites, and please us, please everybody. That's sophistry. We cannot say that lies and truth are equal. They're not. We can't say that all lies are equally untrue. We can't say that for sure, but that's not sophistry. Since all the lies are equally untrue, the Christ child doesn't need to address any lie in particular at all. It just shines the fact to us that all lies are equally untrue, and the lie that we can die, it's not true. It simply is not true. It never will be true. Pure reassurance. Interruption there. It's important to note that the Christ child never has its certainty interrupted. We can be interrupted in the world, but the Christ child within us never loses its certitude at all. There's no wavering at all. There's no saying, wait a minute, I'll be right back. I don't quite have it right now. There's none of that. But we, in our lives, by those who don't recognize the Christ child at all, because it's not from them, it's not of flesh, will certainly interrupt us, and, you know, with no apologies. Right? They say, well, we care about the Christ child. It's not of us, it's not of the flesh, it's not our... it's not our business. It's, you know, what do we have to do with that? Nothing, 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 they say. But that interruption is not the Christ child coming from the Christ child. Let's not rationalize it and say that. No way. It has never had any diminishment whatsoever or break or gap in its certitude. It's pure, it's seamless. It's very important to say this. It's pure, it's seamless, it always will be pure, always will be seamless. There's no gap, no interruption, no break whatsoever in its certitude. So that means it's been with you your entire life in exactly the same certitude and presence, and will continue always in that way for you and for everyone. Doesn't need to take a nap, the mother will say. Well, it's not available right now because, Junior needs a nap. It's sleeping. Christ's child is sleeping. Not true, never sleeps. There's no need for any naps. Doesn't get tired. And maybe the functionaries, maybe the priest will say, it's not a holy day. You can't see it because it only has its potency on certain days. I said, no, it's not true either. Not true. So there are different gatekeepers who have, their tricks. We don't need any gatekeeper. Christ child doesn't need any gatekeeper. It's pure reassurance. It's seamlessly always present. No gaps, no naps. No gaps and no naps. No special days, no unspecial days. So here we are. We lived our whole life thinking, I need to wait till the right time. You're asking all these self-appointed gatekeepers, is it the right time? Can I come in and see it now? Is it? And they say, it's not quite ready for you. Not quite, Now when the Christ child in dreams said to me, I'll be right there, it knew that I needed just a moment myself to, brush up a little more. It's not that it's not ready. It understands that we may not be quite ready, but it's always ready. So the lack of readiness is entirely on us. So anything that says otherwise is completely bogus. 100% bogus. October 15th, isn't it? It's the turning point of October. I tell you, October's always been extremely good to me. For some reason. I think it's because I feel the approaching winter and I don't like it. So I want to somehow get the presence of that which doesn't change into winter, into darkness, into deadness, into all the stuff of winter. Something that retains this eternal summer, It's always, they're saying in the 60s or 70s, it's always summer on the inside. But what we're really saying is the Christ child, its reassurance doesn't have climate to it. It doesn't have seasons to it. So it's not like they say in the song, like the weather, your heart changes it with each season. Not true. It's reassurance remains pure. And invariable. So with October, with the turning towards wintertime, maybe I say, wow, I really need a boost at this time, and I get this boost. But right now, we're going towards a kind of a cosmic winter. It's not just, of course, in the northern hemisphere we're going toward winter, in the southern we're going towards summer. But globally, we're going towards a cosmic winter. So, we really need a boost then, because I hate winter and the lack of light in the cold, and just, it just, wow. I remember I used to refuse to give in to winter. I'd wear shorts the entire year round and a t-shirt. I said, no, the summer is going to return any day, you know, the summer. I refuse to give in to winter time. I used to do that a lot, years, many years. I just would wear summer attire the entire year here in the Bay Area. But it, you know, even though there's some nice days, a lot of days are not so nice in the winter time. So the Christ child doesn't have tantrums, doesn't have moods, doesn't have timeouts. Remember, when you have the darshan of the Christ child, you know the ego's a liar. That's it. It's curtains for the ego. So of course it's going to try and distract you. It's frantic to do so. The other thing the ego will say is, don't look there, there's nothing there. You'll be looking into nothing. Not true, not true. You'll be looking into reassurance. Reassurance is not nothing. You'll be looking into positive reassurance, positive reassurance. Not a void, positive reassurance. So, seems like the message has been sent here, and we'll get it up on YouTube. And thanks to all the viewers. Welcome to the new viewers. And there's a lot of interest right now in this, because we know cosmic winter is coming. Call it whatever you want, the tribulation period. We know that a harsh winter is coming. Harsh cosmic winter is coming. And we're looking for something that does not shift that way. Okay, that stays constant. A constant positive. Constant positive reassurance. We're looking for that. It's within us. It is within us. But we are misdirected in so many ways from it. Just frightened off from it. Unreceptive to it. Thinking we need to jump through all these hoops, you know, for it, that we're insensitive to it, that we need to learn all this archaic, metaphysical, esoteric, blah, 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 blah. None of that is true. None of that is true. The real brush up is simplicity. Very clear simplicity about what it is, why it's there, how we benefit from it. Just the basics. What I find is everybody overlooks the basics. Instead, they're going through all this complexity. And all we need is the basics. There isn't anything more. anything other than that just clutters up and makes us all awkward, and we feel we can't cope with it, cope with our awkwardness. So like my feeling now is like a lack of awkwardness in relation to this situation. I'm still trying to iron out, you know, wrinkles. For instance, will the Christ child, is he asking you a question? No. And like, what is your relationship with, you know, people? And will it say, well, how do you relate to my mother? No. Doesn't have a mother. How do you relate to my father? No. Doesn't have a father, so to speak, as Holy Spirit. And people say, well, how have you been relating to the Holy Spirit? I said, very well. Thank you. And that's, you know, that's easy to answer. But it's not like you're being interrogated at all. It's the very fact that you're there answers the question. Any questions that could arise is answered by that. The very fact that your attention is there is the answer. It's proved the point. There's no need for a question. There's no need for a question. Because again, the reassurance is not relative to something in the world. So it's not saying, you're not trying to say, well, how am I going to be able to, treat other people better or this or that. No, that's not the issue at all. It's you're being reassured, you're gaining remembrance of reality. That's the only thing you're getting. That's the only thing of importance. So the Christ child is not trying to teach you ethics or morals or behavior or how to take this back to the world and build a better world or anything like that. No. Nothing like that. It has no viewpoint on the world at all, except that it's a complete presumption and we could never die. That's it. So we realize we don't need to build a better world. We don't need to do anything externally at all, really. We just need to listen to the Holy Spirit, brush up, and have Darshan and the Christ child, and that's it. And we are going to then have no fear of dropping perception eventually. No fear of that anymore. And others will relate to you and say, ah, there's somebody that's doing it. Okay, that's great. They'll relate to that. That's what you want them to relate to. So you don't get caught up in saying, how can I use this, Darshan? How can I make it useful? No. Its usefulness is in not worrying about how do I make it useful. It's because you don't need to make it useful. It is useful. It is the usefulness. So you're paying attention to the usefulness. It is the usefulness. It is what is useful. That is what is useful. The rest is sophistry. It's trying to develop a perfect concept, which it's trying to develop death. That's what it's trying to do. And that's useless. All right. Well, I'll make videos as the Spirit moves me to do so. Just keep on brushing up. Be urgent in the consistency of your brushing up, because it's very important right now. Otherwise, we will get caught up in the sophistry that is taking place in the world. And I'm telling you, it is intense. It is so intense. It is a trap. Many will get caught up in that trap. There's no question about it. Scripture tells us that the times will become so intensely full of sophistry that even those who want to have darshan of the Christ child, even those are in danger of getting swept away by the sophistry. And we're certainly in those times, there's no question about it. So maintain a steady pace. That's the best thing right now. Maintain a steady pace. That's what I'm trying to do here. Okay? Maintain a steady pace. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.